These slides tell us how the sympathetic nervous system at the molecular level, how they're able to increase the heart contractility. Sympathetic nervous system use epinephrine and norepinephrine. In the heart, they bind with the beta-1 receptor. Those adrenergic receptors, they trigger the second messenger, and the second messenger is cyclic AMP. They are able to increase the contractility by regulate calcium. Remember the first slides I show you the contractility depends on calcium. So they want to make more calcium available and also quickly remove the calcium from the SR after they've been released so they can release the calcium quickly again. So they can regulate the calcium from the entry from the ECF to the cell by making those voltage gate calcium open, calcium channel open for longer. Open the time. They can also work on the SR. And on the SR, you have the phospholipin, that's the protein. Phospholipin, that's the protein, it work on the calcium pump. So calcium pump is the pump use the calcium, ATP as the energy source. It pump the calcium from the SR back to the, from the ECF back to the SR. So the quicker you remove calcium, the more efficient you can release the calcium again. So you can quickly remove the calcium from the cytosol. And also you put more calcium into the SR. The next time you release, there are more calcium go out. That's the second calcium, right? Second calcium trigger the calcium release. So you can work on the first calcium, you can work on the second calcium. And also the more efficient you remove the calcium from the cytosol, you can shorten the calcium's make the whole system become, the interval become shorter. So you can contract faster, shorter duration. So that's how the sympathetic system can efficiently work on the, at the molecular level, work on the stroke volume and heart rate. So together, cardio output increase. And this slide show you your volume and contracting force change. It's called the Starling's law. Starling's law tell you your heart love to work. So when you send more blood back to your heart, to your ventricle, talking about the ventricle, you're gonna send more blood out. And you can use the increase the venous return by increase your respiratory pump, increase your veins contraction, your skeletal pump. And both of them are going to send more blood back to the heart. And when you send more blood to the back to the ventricle, it's going to contract more. So it's a linear relationship before it reaches the limit of the heart muscle. It's 300 mL. That's a lot. So in a normal situation, you won't be able to send that much. So it's a linear relationship. When you're resting, that's this. And you have about 135 mil in the stretch volume in your left ventricle. The contracting force is this. And when you exercise, your sympathetic nervous system increases it. So you send more blood back to the ventricle, it's going to contract more. The contracting force is more. If you ask me why the contracting force, they use the mil. They use the stroke volume to represent the contracting force. Because in the real situation, especially when the heart is working, there's no way we can measure the contracting force of the heart. So they use the stroke volume, how much volume being sent out to the aorta from the left ventricle to represent the contracting force. Because when the contracting force increases, stroke volume increases. So that's why the y-axis is still a volume, but it actually represents the contracting force. So it's a linear relationship in the normal physiological situation. So this tell you when you exercise, you increase the end diastolic volume, you increase the contracting force. Your heart love to work. And even better, your autonomic nervous system release norepinephrine. So norepinephrine gonna increase, make the whole line shift up. So in a normal situation without norepinephrine, it's a linear relationship already. You send more blood back, you're gonna send more blood out. With norepinephrine, even better. Its contracting force is increased. Because of this, your autonomic nervous system can quickly increase your cardio output. Take seconds, to increase your cardio output in the emergency situation, so your body can able to handle those emergency situations efficiently. Okay, we're in the end of the heart. So let's talk about two terminology, preload, afterload. So what's preload? Preload is how much volume you send into the heart. That's preload. So preload is the volume. And actually preload is the end diastolic volume. That's how much volume you send back to the heart. So that's the end diastolic volume. When you increase the preload, of course you're going to send more blood out. So increased preload actually helps the cardio output. Then what's the afterload? Afterload is not good. If you think about the heart, preload is good one. You send more, increase preload, increase the cardio output. Afterload will decrease. What's afterload? Afterload is the best way to think about it. That's the pressure to prevent the blood to go out. So that's your heart, your left ventricle, need to send the blood from the left ventricle to the aorta. That's the pressure. There's a door, right, called the semilunar valve. And that's the pressure to prevent it send out. If you have a low afterload, it's like I want to push the door open. Low afterload is I can easily push the door open, low resistance. High afterload is there's three of you, you don't like me, so you stand outside, you push the door. So now I have to work very hard to push the door open to go out. That's increased afterload. So you can imagine afterload is bad. What can cause increased afterload? High blood pressure. Blood pressure, you have the systolic pressure, you have the diastolic pressure. Diastolic pressure is the blood pressure when your heart is relaxing. High diastolic pressure means the afterload when the heart is relaxing. The pressure here, that's the pressure from aorta, is high due to the blood vessel lose elasticity due to the blood vessel being blocked. So when you increase the afterload, it's actually bad. So we do have people, they have measured their blood pressure, they have normal mean arterial pressure or just a little bit higher mean arterial pressure. And the mean arterial pressure comes from the systolic and diastolic. And sometimes you found the doctor will pay more attention to the diastolic pressure. And they found, okay, your systolic pressure is normal, but your diastolic pressure is higher. And I know some doctor actually pay more attention to the diastolic pressure. Because this is like the potential danger factor. Because there's afterload. So if your afterload is big, well, your heart, you need to work harder to push the door open to send the blood to the aorta. And even though your blood pressure looks normal, this one is higher. That's the potential factor because it can exhaust your heart. Okay, so that's the conclusion. We talk about the heart. We spend so much time talking about the electrical events, mechanical events, how the blood send out. So, and we talk about the preload, the afterload, and how the autonomic nervous system affect the stroke volume. So we know the preload, positive means it helps. It helps the blood send out. You can use the venous return, you can use the skeletal pump, respiratory pump, increase the preload, send more blood in because of starting slow, you're going to send more blood out. You can increase the contractility, this is a positive effect. This is based on the available calcium inside the cardiac muscle. So you give them more calcium available, bigger contractility, this can increase. Then we talk about the afterload. Afterload is actually not so good because that's the pressure to push, prevent blood send out. So when you increase the afterload, it's a negative effect. What causes afterload? Well, you have the hypertension. So hypertension is a potential danger for cardiovascular disease. Okay, that's it.